Hello everybody, I'm Rémi Galland, researcher in the team Quantitative Imaging of the Cells at the Interdisciplinary Institute for Neuroscience. As part of the FBI training on the light-sheet fluorescence microscopy or SPIM techniques, I'm going to present you a light-sheet microscope architecture we developed within the team and we named SOSPIM. As I will show you, these specific implementations offer several advantages, from its multi-scale imaging ability to the standardizations and the parallelizations of both the culture and the imaging of complex 3D cell culture. During this video, I will first present you a general overview of the SOSPIM's working principle, SOSPIM's main component, and its main 3D imaging capacities. Then, we will dive into the practical aspect of the SOSPIM imaging process from the samples preparations and culturing protocol up to the image acquisition process. In particular, I will show you how the SOSPIM unit technology enables to synergize high-density 3D cell culture with 3D light-sheet imaging into a single platform. Now, let's start with the SOSPIM principle and imaging capabilities. Standard light-sheet implementations is based on at least two objectives, perpendicular one from the other, in order to create a thin light-sheet on one side and collect perpendicularly the fluorescent signal on the other side. This specific illumination architecture allows for unprecedented capacity to image living samples in 3D at high spatial and temporalizations and with very low photodamaging effect. However, this multi-objective architecture comes with important mechanical constraints. On one side, it complexifies the way to mount the samples in between the objectives and thus limits the potential imaging throughput. And on the other side, it prevents the possibility to use high numerical aperture objectives, which are usually bulkier, and hence it limits the resolutions and the overall sensitivity of the system. With the SOSPIM system, we came with the idea to replace the excitation objective by a 45-degree mirror directly integrated into the mini imaging device. Reflection of a laser beam onto this mirror enabled to create a light sheet perpendicular to the objective, which in turn can be also used to collect the fluorescent signals. And this specific architecture enables both to conserve the main advantages of light sheet-based 3D live imaging, and in addition, it releases the mechanical constraint of standard multi-objective light sheet microscope, therefore opening the possibility to use whatever objective we want, such as the bulky high numerical aperture ones. However, it comes with the need to use dedicated devices, but we will see that this requirement can be turned into an advantage to parallelize both the culture and the imaging of our samples. The SOSPIM system looks like this. It is compatible with any infrared microscope and therefore benefits from their standard imaging modalities such as epifluorescence or fast contrast imaging, and it is composed of three main components. Microfabricated devices, which integrate the 45-degree mirror, allowing to create the excitation light sheet. They are positioned as any standard post-sample on an infrared microscope and allow for 3D sample culture. We developed several designs of such devices adapted to different kinds of samples, from single cells to spheroids or organoids. Especially, we designed truncated pyramid-shaped wells that allow to culture and image 3D spheroids as shown on the figure. They are displayed into a precise array, and I will come back on how to use them later in the presentation. A beam steering unit, which is directly plugged at the backport of the microscope and allows us to control the laser beam into the image plane. It allows to adjust the light sheet thickness in between 1 and 5 micrometers for a length ranging in between 10 to 300 micrometers and to control the light sheet 3D positions according to the sample location in respect to our 45-degree mirror. And lastly, a software which enables to synchronize the process to perform 3D imaging. It is a plugin running into the acquisition software Metamorph distributed by Molecular Device, and it handles the synchronization of the light sheet 3D movement with the axial displacement of the objective to allow for 3D imaging. Now let's look at the imaging capabilities of the SOSPIM technology. The first important feature of the SOSPIM architecture is its capacity to image many different kinds of samples spanning a very large range of sizes, simply adapting the mirror size and shape to the samples we want to image. Using small mirror, we are able to image at the single cell scale with improved 3D and live capacity and even single molecule sensitivity. Using bigger mirror of 100 to 200 micrometer depth, such as the one in our GWAL devices, we are able to image at the spheroids and organoid scales of few hundreds of micrometers. Finally, using millimeter-sized mirror, we can image up to the whole small organism, such as the whole Drosophila embryo. We can here emphasize that those samples has been imaged using different objectives with different magnifications, simply turning the objective turret of the microscope body on which the SOSPIM system is plugged. Now I would like to highlight more specifically two different imaging capabilities of the SOSPIM technology, which are really its strengths. First, its high sensitivity and intrinsic optical sectioning allows performing single molecule localization microscopy in depth tens of microns above the coral slip. In combination with an astigmatism-based 3D localizations, we demonstrated our ability to achieve resolutions down to 10 nanometer radially and 15 nanometer axially, 15 micrometer above the coral slip, as we can see in this movie of single molecule and in this color-coded 3D reconstructions of a single aquarium plane. Then we implemented a possibility to sequentially and automatically acquire tens of planes slightly defocused one from the other. It therefore opens the possibility to image entire cells over a volume of around 20 by 20 by 20 cubic micrometer with nanometric resolutions. In this case, we image a PD-1 receptor on the membrane of a suspended Jurkat T cells. It represented 35 planes acquired every 400 nanometer with 25,000 frames acquired each plane, and for a total acquisition time of 13 hours and 600,000 localizations detected. Using a SRTCLR segmentation tool developed within the team, we were then able to segment in 3D this PD-1 cluster along the membrane and extract quantitative information such as their size, volume, density, and so on. A second, the SOSPIM microfabricated G-wells that integrate the 45-degree mirror make possible to parallelize and standardize both the culture and the imaging of complex 3D cell culture. The G-wells offer a perfect micro niche to make gross 3D cell culture in a very controlled manner. In collaboration with the Mechanobiology Institute in Singapore, we demonstrated our capacity to make grow and differentiate human embryonic stem cells within our G-wells into functional organoids. In addition, those G-wells are directly compatible with SOSPIM 3D imaging, which allow avoiding any sample manipulations in between the culture and the imaging process, and thus simplifying the overall experiment protocol. It also benefits from all the advantages of light-sheet-based 3D imaging in terms of speed, resolutions, and low photodamaging effects, what allow monitoring in live the growth of our 3D cell culture. Finally, the G-wells are arranged along a precise array, displaying hundreds to thousands of wells per device, opening the possibility to standardize and parallelize both the culture and the imaging of our samples. We hence demonstrated our capacity to automatically record 96 neuro-octagon organoid in 4 colors over a range of 60 microns in less than 1 hour using a single SOSPIM device. The SOSPIM technology can therefore be easily turned into a whole and integrated high-throughput imaging platform that combines high-density and standardized organoid culture with parallel light-sheet-based 3D fluorescence imaging. During the practical demonstrations, I will come back more precisely to this imaging capacity and illustrate how we can design an experiment to monitor in parallel the growth of tens of 3D cell culture along time. With that, we end the quick overview of the working principles and imaging capacity of the SOSPIM system. We will now dive into the practical aspect that we have to consider when performing an experiment on the SOSPIM system, from the biological samples mounting and culturing protocol up to the sample 3D imaging process. First, we will look at the sample preparations and mounting protocol. In particular, we will see that the use of the SOSPIM device enables to mount and culture hundreds to thousands of samples at the same time into a unique support. We'll first go through the SOSPIM device preparations and functionalization protocol. Then we will see how to seed and culture our cells of interest into the SOSPIM well. Here, even if I will demonstrate this step culturing simple spheroid for clarity reasons, the same principles could be applied to make grow organoids as long as the appropriate culture protocol are respected. Finally, we'll see that further manipulations such as fixation and staining can directly be made into those culture support. And more importantly, one then only need to position the culture support or SOSPIM device onto our inverted microscope to image in 3D and a long time our samples, limiting at its maximum their manipulations. So let's see now the SOSPIM device preparations and cell seeding steps. First, we'll need to prepare our device, which will host our samples and possibly functionalize it depending on our culture protocol. We thus need to choose the device adapted to the samples we want to image. Those devices are usually directly mounted onto a bottom-free Petri dish. In our case, we choose a device displaying G-wells with a depth of about 100 micrometer and a top opening of 100 micrometer to culture spheroids. We then pour ethanol onto the device. It has two objectives. First, to clean and somehow sterilize them. It can also be combined with a UV illumination step for further sterilizations. Second, it will allow us removing any bubbles that may be trapped into the wells, putting the sample into a vacuum chamber. Once outgassed, the device looks like this, where we don't see any more bubbles trapped into the wells as compared to before. Then, we need to functionalize or passivate our device according to the sample we want to culture. In our case, we choose to passivate our device with a solution of 0.5% of Lipidur diluted in pure ethanol. Lipidur is a very robust anti-fouling agent that will prevent any cell adhesions on the wells for a very long time, up to a month, in order to make growth suspended spheroids. To do so, we just have to remove the ethanol already present into our petri dish and pour our Lipidur solutions on top of our device. The solution is then allowed to completely be evaporated under a sterile hood, usually in about 2 hours, in order to form an homogeneous anti-fouling coating on all the device. Before seeding, the well are rinsed with PBS and outgassed once again as previously. When the sample has been outgassed and functionalized, it is now the time to seed the cells into our wells. First, we need to rinse the device several times with PBS and then pour culture media to make it ready to welcome cells. Here, I want to stress out that this capacity to pour and remove any solutions or media from the device without drying out the wells is crucial for all further sample preparation steps such as cell seeding and culture, and later on sample fixation and staining. This capacity is really important and enables us to limit at its maximum any sample manipulation from the seeding of the cells up to the imaging process. This is a clear advantage of the SOSPIM system as compared to other light sheet fluorescence microscopy implementations for which sample mounting can be complex. If we look at the sample under the microscope, all the wells arranged along a precise array are now filled with the culture media and are ready to welcome cells. Then it is time to seed the cell into the wells. First, we need to detach our cell of interest from their culture in flask using standard protocol, in our case with trypsin. We then resuspend the cells in our warm culture media and concentrate the solutions to have a final cell concentration in between 200,000 and 1 million cells per milliliter according to the number of cells we target per well. For the seeding process, we just have to remove the culture media from our SOSPIM device and pour one or two drops of our cell solutions on top of the well. Gravity will do the rest, and the cells will fall down into the wells, as we can see here after 10 to 15 minutes of incubation. Washing the remaining cells with culture media and repeating this seeding step several times allow adjusting the final number of cells we end up with per well. For these demonstrations, we are using a colon cancer cell line, HEP3B, which stably express the histone protein H2B tagged with the fluorescence protein GFP. Finally, after several hours of culture, cells that can't adhere to the wells due to the Lipidur coating start to form aggregates as we can see under our microscope using a 10x objective. We can now use our own culture protocol to make further grow the spheroid before imaging or fixations and staining. It is also compatible with any differentiation protocol with the addition of specific growth factor and or extracellular matrix such as matrigel. To summarize this part, the SOSPIM device enables to directly culture our cell of interest following our favorite culture protocol and according to those three steps: seeding, aggregations, and further cell proliferation and induction. One has to note that the seeding step allows for precise control of the amount of cells per well, controlling the timing and the cell concentration of the seeding solutions. Also, spin device, or GWELs, enables us to standardize and parallelize the growth of our 3D cell culture, which can be crucial for systematic study or screening assay on complex samples such as organoids. Then, thanks to our capacity to remove and pour new media into the SOSPIM device without drying out the wells, all subsequent sample preparations can be done directly into the SOSPIM device, from the fixation to the immunostaining steps, greatly limiting any sample manipulations. Here we can stress out that the shape of the wells in truncating pyramid enables to somehow trap our 3D cell culture into the G-wells, avoiding any material loss despite the numerous solution exchange for culture, fixations, and staining. Now that we have prepared our device with our samples, I will show you how to perform a 3D imaging experiment using the SOSPIM system, and more specifically, how to set up a time-lapse multiposition experiment to monitor the growth of several of our spheroids long time, which is a clear advantage of the SOSPIM technology and supports. First, I will show you how we need to calibrate the system to ensure optimal 3D imaging of our samples. Then we will parameterize an experiment to perform 3D multicolor imaging and 3D time-lapse multiposition imaging combining our SOSPIM software and already implemented tool in the acquisition software of Metamorph. The first calibration has to be done in order to superpose the galvanometric mirror space onto the camera space. This is mandatory in order to accurately control the laser beam positions into the image plane and thus onto the 45-degree mirror to create our light sheets. This calibration is stable for months and need only to be repeated when the hardware, such as the camera, the objective or the filter cube, has been moved. For this calibration step, we use a cover slip with a fluorescent layer on it, simply made with a fluorescent marker located on our stage holder. We then open the acquisition software Metamorph, under which we can control all our system and start the SOSPIM plugin. The SOSPIM software is composed of several panels. The control panel, which allow controlling all the light sheet parameters, such as its width and its 3D position into the sample. This panel also enables to select the laser line we want to use and adjust their intensities. In our case, we have four laser lines at 405, 488, 561, and 640 nanometer. And it includes a part to handle the synchronization of all the hardware with the camera to ensure optimal 3D imaging. I will come back to that part on the next couple of slides in which I will present the synchronization protocol. We also have access to a panel to adjust the parameter of the galvanometric mirror, such as their speed, and a panel allowing to calibrate the galvanometric mirror space according to the camera space, what we will use right now. For these calibrations, we first have to focalize our image plane onto the fluorescent layer on top of our clear sheet. To do so, we open the acquisition window of Metamorph and select a bright field illumination mode, and then adjust the axial position of our objective. Once focalized on the fluorescent layer, we can switch to a SOSPIM illumination mode using one of our laser lines. In this case, I will use the 561 nanometer channel. In the calibration tab, I select to draw a rectangle with our galvanometric mirror, and then I start the acquisitions. Of course, I have to raise the laser intensity to observe it on the fluorescent layer. I then have to adjust the size of this rectangle so that it fits perfectly onto the camera field of view, as the calibration will be done and valid inside this rectangle. For that, we can directly displace and adjust the size of the rectangle in the SOSPIM plugin. We then start the calibration process. The laser beam is scanned within this rectangle, and for each galvo mirror position, the spot is detected and localized in the camera space. It enables us to compute the relationship in between the galvo mirror and the camera space. Finally, we can check the validity of the calibrations clicking on this button. In this mode, the laser beam should be positioned at the mouse positions in the camera field of view. Another calibration or synchronization procedure needs then to be done in order to accurately synchronize the movement of the light sheet with the axial position of the objective and of the camera exposure, to ensure optimal 3D imaging over the entire depth of our mirror or sample. This step will make sure that the excitation plane and the image plane are always superposed and that the thinnest part of the light sheet stay always centered into the samples we want to image in order to optimize the achievable optical sectioning. This calibration is usually stable for days and can be done either directly on our device containing your samples or image, or using a calibration samples filled with the fluorescent solutions in order to better visualize your laser beam and somehow simplify the process. It usually has to be done each time we change the objective or the filter cue. To perform these synchronizations, we use a SOSPIN device containing no biological sample but which has been filled with the fluorescent solutions, here a concentrated calcein solution. This sample is simply positioned on our microscope stage on top of the objective. We then open the SOSPIN software as well as the metamorph acquisition window and the control window for all of our Z piezo stage we are going to use when performing 3D imaging. We adjust the focus of our objective onto the device using a bright field illumination mode, and here we can see that the shape of the or pyramidal well and adjust the focalization either at the bottom or at the top of our G-wells. The first and mandatory step is to tell to the software the orientation of the mirror, so that it knows how to scan the laser in order to create the light sheet after reflection on the mirror, and how to display the light sheet in depth for 3D imaging. To do so, we typically focalize our image plane on top of our mirror and simply draw a line that follows the orientation of the mirror. We can then display this line in the middle of our mirror and enter it into the SOSPIN software using this button. Scanning our laser beam along this line will thus enable to create a light sheet perpendicular to our objective after reflection onto the mirror. We then just have to display the laser beam perpendicular to this line to change the axial positions or depths of the light sheets. So, if we now switch on our laser and camera, we can see our laser beam after reflection onto the 45 degree mirror. Of course, we need to adjust the axial position of our objective so that it images the same plane that it excited by the laser after reflection onto the mirror. As we are using a Gaussian beam, we observe the standard focalization of such a beam, with the thinnest part of the beam corresponding to the interesting portions for which the optical sectioning will be optimal. Thus, this is this part that we will have to move in 3D simultaneously and synchronously with the image plane to perform optimal 3D imaging. Before the synchronization process, let's review some features of the SOSPIN beam steering unit and software. First, we can control the position of the light sheet according to the mirror in order to localize its thinnest part at the sample position. To do so, we adjust the weight scroll bar on the SOSPIN software and as we can see, it moves the thinnest part of the light sheet closer or further from the mirror. Second, we can adjust the parameter of the light sheet such as its thickness and length depending on the samples we want to image. Indeed, we implemented a motorized iris into the optical path in order to change the laser beam diameter and thus the light sheet properties as we can see now. By this way, we are able to create light sheets with a thickness from 1 up to 5 micrometer and a length from 10 to almost 300 micrometer. Now, let's jump into the synchronization process itself, which is crucial to perform optimal 3D imaging. Indeed, it will ensure that the excited plane remains always superposed and centered with the image plane. To do so, we first move the axial position of our objective to be focalized almost at the top of the mirror. We thus see that the light sheet is out of focus. We thus adjust the position of the laser beam onto the mirror to superpose the excited plane with the image plane. Here we mark the position of the thinnest part of the light sheet and tell to the SOSPIN software that we are at the top of the mirror and that everything is correctly adjusted. Then we move down our objective to go almost at the bottom of our mirror and we adjust the Z position of our light sheet to make it superpose with the image plane. We can see here that the thinnest part of the light sheet is no more centered, yet we want that it remains always at the same position to ensure that we will have always the best optical sectioning at our sample positions when performing 3D imaging. We thus adjust the position of the waist to put it back at the same positions as at the top of the 45 degree mirror and tell to the software that everything is adjusted at the bottom of our mirror. Thanks to these two calibration points, we can now synchronize the axial movement of the objective with the displacement of the light sheet so that everything stays always superposed and centered for 3D imaging, as we can see here when moving our Z piezo stage. We can now adjust the width of the light sheet, its position in the camera field of view, or the position of the thinnest part of the light sheet according to the size and the position of the post samples in our well. Before to image your Silurian live, I will show you how we can easily perform a 3D multicolor acquisition on a single well. For that, we are going to image 200 to 300 micrometer wide cysts made of stem cells that have been fixed and labeled for DAPI, the differentiation marker SOX2 and the actin signal. Those cysts have been seeded into 400 micrometer wide G-wells, the same way we seed cells to create our spheroids. To handle any multidimensional acquisition, we will now use the multidimensional acquisition tool of Metamorph. Indeed, this tool enables to parameterize complex acquisitions such as time-lapse, multipositions, multicolor, 3D acquisitions, and automatically handle the saving of the acquired image. It looks like this. First, we define the saving parameter, in your case, the image of our cyst. Then, we select the wavelength we want to use. For the moment, bright field to select our well and samples to image, and the 4 or 5 SOSPIM illumination channel to image the DAPI signal. We can now select the well we want to image and define the mirror orientations. Of course, the synchronizations have been done previously, and any displacement of the objective will drive the displacement of the light sheet accordingly. We can check that this synchronization is correct on our samples, imaging the DAPI signals and moving the axial position of the objective like this. In this case, we observe that the calibrations work perfectly fine. Now we have to parameterize the multidimensional acquisition tool to perform a multicolor 3D acquisition. We therefore select multi-wavelength, this array, and the stream option in the front panel of the MDA tool. The stream option will enable us to acquire the 3D volume as fast as the camera allows. We then select the wavelengths we want, in our case the bright field acquisitions, at a single plane and 3D acquisition using excitation at 405, 488 and 640 to image the DAPI signal, the SOX2 signals and the actin signal respectively. Then we define the 3D volume we want to acquire, here a volume of 16 microns around the current positions, which minimizes every 1 micron. In the stream tab we then ask to perform a stream in Z and to use the user program SOSPIM. In these configurations, all the light sheet positions required for 3D acquisitions are computed before the acquisition process. The MDA tool will then just trigger the camera acquisitions along with the Z displacement of the piezo stage and of the light sheets. We can now select the region of interest we want to acquire and adjust the laser intensities for each channel we have to select. Here to image the DAPI signals, the SOX2 signals and the actin signal. We end launching the acquisition process. Here, the acquisition process is in real time. To review the acquisition we have done, we can now merge our different channels altogether and go through the volume acquired. We clearly see the DAPI signals and some SOX2 positive cells as well as the cortical actin signals of each cell of our cyst. An important property of the SOSPIM device is that they display tens to hundreds or thousands of wells per device, arranged along a precise array. We can therefore easily go from one well to another in order to image several cysts or samples in a single experiment, greatly increasing the acquisition throughput of a single experiment. We just select another good-looking samples we want to image, adjust the light sheet depth in order to make superpose the excited and image plane. We can also adjust the light sheet waste according to the sample positions and to the wells in order to optimize the optical sectioning and thus the final Z resolution of our acquisitions. And then we launch the acquisition process on a specific region of interest. We will now see how we can relatively easily parameterize the multi-position time-lapse 3D acquisitions in order to leverage on the SOSPIM device architecture and monitor several samples in parallel, greatly increasing the acquisition throughput of a single experiment. In that perspective, we develop several tools in order to assist for the detection of the wells we want to image and stabilize the system for long-term acquisitions. The acquisition workflow is therefore divided into two parts. The first step consists doing a scan slide of the whole surface of our device in order to automatically detect all the wells present in the device and simplify their selection. Then, using the MDA tool, we are able to parameterize and launch a time-lapse multi-position acquisition for which we develop a tool to correct for the potential drift and allow stable acquisition over a long period of time up to days. As an example, we here acquired 4 positions for 18 hours every 90 seconds over a volume of 70 micrometer with no noticeable drift or image quality degradations nor phototoxic effects. To set up a multi-position time-lapse acquisition, we first start with the acquisition of an image of the whole device in bright field using the scan slide tool of Metamorph. After calibrating the stage axis according to the camera field of view, we define the upper left and lower right corner of the field of view we want to acquire. Here we make sure to encompass the whole whale array in order to get an image of all the Ouija whales present in our device. And then we launch the scan slide acquisitions. Here the video speed has been increased 20 times, and we measure that it takes around 20 minutes to acquire an 8x8mm field of view with our 60x objective. Then we develop an automatic detection tool of all the G-wells present on the scan slide image based on basic filtering and threshold adjustments. Once all the G-wells detected, we can then select or unselect the one we want to image, clicking on the corresponding region of interest on our scan slide image. The positions of all the selected G-wells are then directly sent to the MDA tool that will handle the multi-position acquisition process. Indeed, we can see that all the positions have been saved into the stage panel of the MDA tool. Here we have selected 20 positions we can sort in order to minimize the overall distance objective we have to travel. We can now navigate through all these positions and check whether the excitations and image plane are correctly superposed to allow for optimal 3D imaging on all our positions. Here the positions that have been selected have been automatically corrected according to a G-well reference position in which the light sheet has been adjusted to ensure this superposition. We now have to define the acquisition parameter for our multi-position time-lapse acquisition. We first define the channels we want to acquire, and adjust the light sheet widths and positions according to the samples into our G-well. Here we choose to acquire at each position a single image in bright field and a 3D stack in the 4, 5 and 6 40nm channels to image the DAPI and the actin signal respectively. We then define the file and name that will be used to save our data and define the acquisition volume we want to perform, here a volume of 60 microns around the current these positions. We then select the time-lapse options on the front MDA panel and adjust its parameter. Here we choose to acquire an image every 5 minutes on our 20 positions for 10 tie points. Of course, we can adjust the frequency and duration of our acquisitions according to the samples and biological events we want to capture. We end checking that the stream option is correctly configured to ensure 3D stream imaging. Finally, we launch the acquisition process. All the stage displacements, 3D acquisitions, and data saving are now handled by the MDA tool. We can see that the system is sufficiently stable to allow for optimal 3D imaging on those 20 positions and 10 time points. For longer acquisitions, we develop a repositioning tool based on the high contrast of our G-wells when imaged in bright field. This tool enables to correct the G-well positions at a user-defined frequency according to the stability of our system, and therefore ensure optimal 3D imaging over the whole duration of the acquisitions. We demonstrated that this tool enables us to perform time-lapse acquisitions of up to 40 hours without any noticeable deterioration of the 3D imaging quality. Once the acquisition is finished, we can navigate through our dataset using already implemented tools in Metamorph before exporting them for further treatment and analysis. We can typically check the image quality at our different positions and channels and a long time, and perform some basic image treatment such as maximum intensity projections and channel overlay as shown here on some of the positions we just imaged. With that, I hope I convince you that the SOSPIM technology offers a new and unique platform to image samples spanning a very large range of sizes, from single cells with single molecule sensitivity up to whole organisms, and that this platform allows us to standardize and parallelize both the culture and the 3D imaging in live of complex cellular cultures. And before ending this video, I would just like to acknowledge all the people involved in the development of the SOSPIM technology, both in Singapore within the Mechanobiologic Institute and in Bordeaux at the Interdisciplinary Institute for Neuroscience, as long as our financial support and industrial partnership. I would also like to thank the people involved in the France Bioimaging Working Group on Lighting Microscopy Techniques. And of course, I thank you for your attention, and I will meet you at the question and answer sessions to answer to all the questions you might have about the SOSPIM technology and its image capacity.